This podcast contains language that is not appropriate for children, including jizz-draped piss candle, cock bandit, and metric fuckton.
I would have let out with metric fuckton because otherwise there's just like no chill on that.
You know what?
And I don't know how our sponsor tonight is going to feel about that.
Probably really bad.
Yeah. Well, tonight's episode of the Science Enthusiast podcast is brought to you by the alt-right. You know that kid who didn't pay attention to U.S. history class in high school and the one who would skip class or fall asleep? Well, now they have their own spinoff show called the alt-right, since they want to combine the failed ideas of Nazis, who had almost absolute control, and the Confederacy, who wanted smaller and less involved government. Combining these two ideologies literally does not make any fucking sense, but far be it for me to tell a racist what to think. The alt-right. I did not see that coming.
Oh, I see what you did there.
Hello, and thanks for listening to the Science Enthusiast podcast. My name is Dan, and as always, I am joined by my, friend Natalie.
Thank you for that amazing introduction. I'm super happy to be here.
Spoiler alert, you're the one that wrote it.
Yeah, I know. I write all the Google Docs. I am the keeper of the Google Docs.
We have a fucking network of them now too, because now we have like our Google Docs. We have a Google Doc just to track all our Google Docs.
To sort the Google Doc. It's called Archives. it's the podcast Archives, and we're over 30 Google Docs at this point. So, yeah, can you believe you've had to do this with me every week for? This is lots of weeks. This is months.
there's a divorce joke in there somewhere. I don't know where it's at.
I don't know, but can we stay together for the kids?
I did that for a few years.
Oh man.
I shouldn't laugh about it.
Let's stay together for the listeners. All of them. All right, so we're not going to do a God of the Week this week, because I'm just lazy, I guess. But you're going to talk about something.
Yeah, there was a comment today on, it was actually a Venn diagram that you shared. I fucking love Venn diagrams. And the comment.
So this was actually my fault.
Yeah.
Put this off.
Yeah, you were the maybe just the catalyst here.
Yeah, catalyst.
So bless her heart here. No punctuation left on this. You atheists love bringing up God. You are a hypocrite to atheism. But deep down in your heart, you know there is a God. He is coming soon. The pauses were my interpretation of her hitting enter, but not using any punctuation in there. I have to assume that's how she says that when she talks. So, yeah, my only problem with that, every single generation ever has always said that God or Jesus are coming. And when militant Christians, yes, I said militant Christians, say this to an atheist, they're doing so in a passively threatening manner in an attempt to bully the atheist into subscribing to their beliefs. So the difference between most atheists, and again, I'm saying most atheists, the ones that aren't dicks, and militant Christians, again, the Christians that are dicks, is that we aren't the ones making threats. We aren't the ones trying to control other people's behaviors, and we aren't the ones telling people what they should believe. They are literally trying to tell us what to believe in an attempt to threaten us or bully us into believing that this sky wizard is coming. And if God does come, then great, I'll believe he's real. I will be one of the first people to post all about how I was wrong on this. What won't change for me is the level of respect I have for this supposedly all-knowing and powerful being who made the decision to not only create cancer, but also give it to kids. And this same being who designed a world where we have to kill things to eat them. And we're even like, we have to eat at all because there's a whole world hunger thing, you know, that's going on in some places. Yeah. He also decided to make pain. you know.
Can we just say he's a dick? He's a dick.
Yeah, that's he's a dick.
Yeah.
So he the whole thing is like he's like the author here. He's writing the story, and so he made all these things, but didn't have to. These were all conscious decisions he made. Things that he wanted to have happen. He wanted pain to exist. He wants people to get cancer. He wants kids to get cancer and die for absolutely no reason other than /LOL, I guess. These are all things that this dick decided to do. It didn't have to do. So even if God does come back, great. I don't give a shit. I'd rather go hang out with Satan. At least I have hookers and beer.
Tonight, we are thrilled to be joined by Matthew O'Neill. Matthew is an activist, theologian, and teacher. He's the author of several books, including Afterlife, Solving Science and Religion's Great Disagreement. And just before we get into things, thank you to David G. McAfee for making the intro between us and Matthew. And we're super happy to have you here tonight, Matthew. So welcome.
Yeah, thank you. I'm very excited to be on. I love this show. So it's like... very excited and happy to be talking with you guys.
Yeah, you've actually listened to some of this, so some of what we've done. So sorry.
No, please.
Thank you.
And, we've become Twitter friends in the process, and I think survived the election together in the past week.
Yes.
Through memes and GIFs and just any image of burning stuff, I guess, is pretty much where we are.
What you call a metaphor.
Yeah, you know. So anyways, since you listen to the show, you know I always like to kind of get people's origin stories, whether it's like their atheist origin story or intro to skepticism, whatever. So with you, I mean, you are a scholar of the Bible, but you're an atheist, right?
Yes, I am an atheist.
So
yes.
I would just like to kind of know, you know, for our audience, a little background, like what brought you there to where you are today, studying the Bible, writing these kind of books, you know, what's your path that took you there?
Yeah, sure. So one quick thing I feel is necessary for me to throw out there is that I am not yet a scholar. I am working in that direction. There's actually like specific criteria I need to meet.
Okay.
Before I am there. So I just got to throw that out there. I'm not there yet. Working towards it, though.
Okay.
So basically, I grew up in a pretty strict Roman Catholic household. I'm actually one of 10 children, if that's any indication of how Catholic we were. I actually ended up attending for both my undergraduate and graduate degrees. The same Catholic school. It's called St. Michael's College, which is pretty close to where I was born and raised. And the very interesting thing about that school was, even though it was a religious school, it was incredibly liberal. I mean, they had like an LGBTQ community. They had like ally safe spaces and all that. Like they were very, very progressive for being
Roman Catholic.
Yeah, exactly. So, sort of like the big breakthrough for me in terms of like gearing towards skepticism was as part of the undergraduate curriculum, like everyone had to take religious education courses. And having grown up Roman Catholic, I was like, well, I'll just take all the Christianity courses because those will probably be the easiest for me. And mm-hmm. I was completely short-sighted in that idea, or just way off the mark in general, because there's so much in there that people just don't realize are in there. And so, I took an Old Testament course, I took an Intro to Christianity course, and in my senior year, because I, like most lazy people, did all of my like curriculum towards my major first, and then put off the stuff I didn't want to do until the end. So I took a New Testament course my senior year, and the professor who taught it was a Catholic priest. And he got up in front of the class and he was giving us this lecture about Revelation, and he sort of stopped what he was saying and said, you know, I just got to like preface everything else I'm about to say with saying that this is all malarkey. This is all bullshit. And it was like crazy for me to think, like, not only is a professor at a Roman Catholic school telling me something out of the Bible is bullshit, it's a priest.
I know, like, does, like, that actually happens. Like, I'm, that's shocking, sort of, right?
Yeah, it's just like the last person you would, it's, you know, it's like your mother confirming, yes, babies come from storks, you know?
Yeah.
So it was just, it was mind-blowing to me, like, wow, okay, so not everything in the Bible is literal. I mean, I knew that well in advance anyway, but it was just weird to hear that from a priest. So I sort of had this taste of skepticism. Over the years, my faith sort of teetered between, like, cafeteria Catholic and then being really devout, cafeteria Catholic being really devout. And once I finished college, I was really sort of in this more deist type of perspective, like, well, I believe in a God, but, you know, I don't believe in all the BS that the church really advocates for. And so about a year or two after that, I was at that point married with my first child, and my this was my first wife. I've since divorced and remarried, but I had seen a book going into a Barnes and Noble one day that just was called God, the Failed Hypothesis. And you know, I had had some passing interest in theology, but didn't really invest too much time into it. But so, as a Valentine's Day gift, my wife bought this book for me and gave it to me, and it was by Victor Stenger. And after reading the first couple chapters, like, I just remember being like, wait, oh my God, this makes so much sense, and there's all these, like, citations, and I can follow where this goes to, and these look like legitimate sources. And so this book really, like, opened the door for me into, like, not only skeptical thinking, but really accepting that, oh my God, there isn't a God. And, like, all that other, and so I started being like, well, what about Jesus? Well, if God's out the window, then so is Jesus too. And I had this, like, mini meltdown, and, you know, I basically drank myself into a coma every night for the next month because it was so difficult for me to accept. But at that point, after I finished reading, I was like, that's really crazy, and I want to know so much more. So I just went out and started reading. And the stuff that I really started gravitating towards more was stuff very specifically around theology and around talking about the different concepts and the different beliefs, and then finding out, oh, well, some of these beliefs aren't actually in the Bible but stemmed from later church fathers, and these were the circumstances around their time, and things started making more sense. And like, the more and more I read about stuff, I started picking up on these little things that most people don't really notice reading through the Bible. Like, one of them, as an example, is, you know, when Jesus goes into Jerusalem for the Passover feast right before he's executed, you know, the Jews are really welcoming him in, and, you know, here comes the Messiah, here comes the King. And then when Pilate brings him out in front of the crowd and says, you know, this man says he's your Messiah, suddenly the same group of Jews are saying, he's wicked, crucify him, and
hashtag not my God.
Yeah, exactly. And so it's like, oh, wow, that's so weird. I never noticed that before. And so that stuff just is really what attracted me to it. So I actually made a comment in an article that I had written and is up on David McAfee's site, which is, you know, I had all this exposure to information around science that really helped me lose my faith. But I'm instead going out and showing, you know, the theology, the religious side of things, and being like, this is why this isn't real. So that's sort of what got me to where I am now with writing these books and pursuing the PhD. So, yeah.
Well, no, it's like just a really interesting story how you just through your own study, essentially, came to these realizations about beliefs that you'd held and that you didn't like really fight it, or did you feel yourself fighting it at times, like that you want, like, did you feel like you wanted to believe still, or did you feel really open to just letting the reality hit?
Well, I definitely still wanted to believe because, you know, it's much more comfortable,
yeah,
thinking that, you know, there's someone watching over me. There's someone, you know, who's, you know, there's a deity or there's otherworldly things, it's supernatural things that are watching over me. And, you know, when I die, there's going to be a place for me to go to, and, you know, death isn't the end for me. You know, it's this really sort of selfish feeling of like, I want to know that I have protection. I want to know that someone's looking out for me, and I want to know that when I die, that's not the end of me. But I mean, even when that first kicked in, I mean, because it happened while I was reading the God the Failed Hypothesis, that I was just like, no, this can't be real. This can't be real. And it's like, well, it clearly is real because there's examples that he gives and citations. So like there's demonstrable proof that, you know, these things that I believe in don't exist.
So you kind of touched on this a little bit and this. It's something that I've always tended to avoid when I guess we'll say debating somebody regarding religion. I don't consider it to be an honest debate because we're talking almost two different languages. We're talking one that's evidence-based and one that is not
belief-based. But
yeah, belief-based. But you mentioned, you know, like as in your story there, you're talking about how God isn't, you know, you realize like, you know, God isn't real, Jesus isn't real. Is there from like what you've done, I've always avoided talking about, you know, if Jesus is real or not, because there's some evidence, or at least I've read and understand, there's some evidence that he is, but there's also, you know, the hanging question that he might not be. And I've always felt like it's not even worth debating that with somebody, because I'll let you have that one, because if I do debate, well, Jesus wasn't real, then that potentially gives you a win for the person that's arguing in favor of existence, gives them a potential win in that specific argument. So they, you know, then they feel more empowered, more emboldened that, yeah, I proved this atheist wrong. So I guess my question is, I mean, what are your thoughts just about that, about me basically pussing out of even debating it, but also like, I mean, do you think that he was actually somebody that walked around and talked, or do you think that he just completely just figurative, or however they want to say it?
Sure. So I kind of lean, and I say kind of, I'll explain in a second. I lean more towards the idea that there is a possibility that there could have been a historical figure known as Jesus of Nazareth. The problem is, though, that what we're dealing with is that we have to consider that we can't put our modern day understandings of what the evidence is for someone existing or not existing back on those times, because there's a whole bunch of problems that really stack up on this issue. And I remain more agnostic about this issue purely because it's, even though I feel like the evidence can pose itself to be there, like there is some evidence to suggest that someone along those lines did exist, it's really difficult to tell. There's the obvious that, you know, we lacked photography and video cameras and audio recording devices.
But I've seen pictures of Jesus.
Which, interestingly enough, is actually more of a depiction of a Pope's son than it is the actual historical Jesus of Nazareth.
Yeah, oh, no, Jesus was white.
And blonde and blue-eyed.
Yeah, like he looked
and,
like...
And like
yeah.
Rips, like my man's like, he hits the gym on the reg.
Yes. Two people have really like helped steer my vision or my position on this issue. One is Matt Dillahunty, because he has said, you know, I rely on the experts who really have studied this field and know more about it. Yes, there's some bias in there, but there's some bias on the opposite end too, the people who advocate that Jesus did not really exist. So that's on both ends of it. However, the historical process is really flawed because it's not like the sciences and it's not like mathematics where we can demonstrate with 100% certainty what did or did not happen at a certain point in time. It's more of a best guesstimate. It's like we have all these pieces of evidence that suggest this is what could have happened, but we can't know for sure. And there's problems even with the historical evidence that we have that does suggest that Jesus existed, because I mean, from a historical perspective, you know, the big issue is that the literacy rates are incredibly diminished back during this time. It was really a skill that was reserved for the financial elite, So the only people we really have any records from or of are really from the financial elite or from people who really were noteworthy in history. And so Jesus was very likely a small town person from this area right outside of Galilee called Nazareth, which wasn't even anywhere in the field of vision of the Roman Empire because it was way out of the way of Jerusalem, probably the one area in that region they would have gone to, only because there was a huge financial gain to be made out of it. And even if they could have made it out that far, they wouldn't have anyway, because they had leaders in those areas who would, you know, report back to the Roman Empire and bring taxes to them and so on and so on. So, you know, literacy rates are almost non-existent. So no one would have been able to really read or write during that time, especially being a sort of out of the way village. Anyone who could read and write were very far away from there. And this is why we don't have any writings about Jesus until at the very earliest 20 years after his death, at least with the Apostle Paul. So it's just like we do have some stuff to suggest that he was there, but it's very far removed from when the historical Jesus would have lived. It's all at least secondhand, if not third, fourth, fifth hand accounts. And people are putting their own political and religious agendas and priorities into it. So long story short, there's evidence that might suggest a historical Jesus existed, but we can't rely on it with 100% certainty because of factors like that.
Well, and then, and so even still, if there was the historical Jesus that existed, I mean, when we think of Jesus, or when people who are, you know, essentially worshiping Jesus think of him, they're thinking like loaves and fishes and, you know, like walking on water and doing all these supernatural things, and just not, and not taking any of that. Like it doesn't actually matter if there was a historical person named Jesus, who was, you know, stories were told that were essentially a, like, scripture in those stories, they're products of the environment that in which they're created, right? Like,
absolutely.
So then, and then, you know, throw some of the supernatural things in there too for the people who are following it, but it's like that stuff just didn't happen.
Yeah, and, exactly. Like, go figure, this, you know, magic stuff wasn't real.
Well, I still remember there was a quote I remember from an episode of Bullshit with Penn and Teller, that I mean, I obviously don't remember the exact quote, but it was essentially like Penn saying that the easiest way to like turn someone into an atheist is like for them to read the Bible.
Yeah.
Like actually read the Bible, because I mean, even like when we're going to now talk a little bit about like this, what the Bible says about heaven and hell and all the stuff. I mean, it's not what people think it is, right? Like,
exactly.
So yeah, I mean, the things that people are essentially kind of preparing themselves for and waiting for in this sort of otherworldly pleasure that they'll receive after death and all of that, like, it's, they maybe need to read the Bible a little more closely.
Yeah, and you know, that's one of the problems with things like the afterlife. You know, people would be really surprised to see what is, or actually more case in point, what isn't there. And so, you know, what people think is in there is stuff that comes from, you know, different interpretations and different cultural shifts and historical shifts, and, you know, how people's own circumstances really contribute to the narrative that then becomes part of the, really the oral tradition that is the biblical narrative that isn't present in the actual physical form. So, you know, people have talked about, you know, what was the, you know, Bart Ehrman put out a book very recently about what the oral tradition was around Jesus before it made it into the written form. And that's sort of what's going on now, is we've really departed pretty significantly from the written tradition, and that oral tradition is really what has taken command over it. And, you know, if you had Kirk Cameron actually read some of the stuff he's spouting about in these videos that he puts out, I would like to think he would change his tune, or maybe he would just say, you've got the wrong translation. Who knows? So,
well, yeah, because it seems like the faith has sort of evolved based on culture and just whatever people have created rather than what's in the actual text. And so
what I'm hearing you say is that we shouldn't check all girls before they get married to make sure that they're virgins. Is that Is that how we shouldn't be doing that?
Well, Donald Trump would urge otherwise, but but yes,
we 20 minutes. 20 minutes. We made it 20 minutes without talking about it.
Hey, it's a record in our recent episodes.
I broke the seal.
but really, like, it what is actually in and we can start talking about this now, where, you know, people have these ideas of what the afterlife is or isn't. Like, can you talk a little bit about what, like, you can either go, what does the Bible say or what doesn't the Bible say? I guess whichever one, because, you know.
Sure, yeah. So I can start very explicitly with what the Bible does and says, and that's generally what people in mainstream society, the regular lay person, assumes the Bible talks about. So any concept of heaven and a realm above the earth where human souls go to when they die. And the soul even itself is sort of not even really present, at least not in the form that we think of. You know, there's not this this immaterial thing that just departs from our body that contains our consciousness and goes up into the clouds. But really, nor is there this pit that everyone goes to and suffers in for all of eternity either. So these concepts that the mainstream believer really has about heaven and hell, really the majority of people, I think, these concepts that they have aren't present in the Bible. And so what we actually find when we go in and look at the Bible and what it says about these concepts is, first, any concept both of eternal suffering or an eternal paradise joined by God is completely absent. What we find instead is this sort of Greco-Roman concept of the afterlife, where they had Hades, and Hades was this communal underworld afterlife type of concept, where there was a deity of some type that watched over the dead in the underworld, and this deity was called Mot, who was, you know, derived from the Hebrew death. So this god known as death was the one who reigned control over Sheol. And so, after a period of time when the Israelites were brought into exile, first by the Assyrians and then by the Babylonians in the early 6th century BCE, the Sheol suddenly wasn't enough for the Israelites, and they thought, you know, we can't share our afterlife with the people who are denigrating us, with the people who have taken us out of our homeland and taken us away from what they believe to be the land where their God lived. So Sheol suddenly started having these different layers to it, and the further down you went, the worse off you were. I mean, we're not talking fire and brimstone yet, but you know, we're still talking a separation and a sort of hierarchy of who was more righteous in terms of being obedient to the Israelite God, Yahweh. And touching upon that subject too, it's also important to note that there was this very strongly held belief that God did have control over what happened in the afterlife, but God wasn't present there. There's a lot of talk in the Hebrew Bible, specifically in Genesis, in the book of Psalms, and in 2 Kings, that God's realm, like God's, where God reigned, was in the clouds in the dome above the earth. And God would look down upon humanity and say, you know, almost very literally, I don't know why humanity considers themselves worthy enough to have me even look at them. And so.
Super, super nice guy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Like he's, I mean, really? Like that's what you want to worship. I guess
the same God who drowned all of humanity except for one guy and his family
and their boat. Yeah, totally. Like it loving dude. Just
yes.
Awesome. Yes.
Yeah. And so, you know, that's sort of where a lot of the concepts are in the Jewish faith, or at least in the Hebrew Bible around the afterlife. There's some other deities that sort of pop up here and there. But you know, otherwise that's more or less what comes out in the Hebrew Bible. When we get to the New Testament, that idea of Sheol is still there. But we get this interesting new idea. And so in a couple of, different versions of the Bible, Jesus will talk about hell in a couple of passages. There's a couple notable ones in Luke and in Mark where Jesus says something along the lines of, you know, people get thrown into the lake of fire and they suffer there in the flames and they scream and they weep and they gnash their teeth. But the interesting thing is when you get back to the earliest translations that we have in Greek, the name is actually Gehenna or Gehinnom. And what that is it's an actually a very specific location on the southern part of Jerusalem. It was called, if you translate it from Hebrew, it means the Valley of Hinnom, which was this pit where they would, where the Israelite people would throw waste, they would throw human waste, they would put animal carcasses, and it basically was just this ever-blazing fire because people just kept throwing waste in there and animal carcasses, but they also threw prisoners in there too. So people who were punished for crimes, certain crimes that warranted, a death penalty, that they would throw them into this fiery pit as well.
So it was a literal fiery pit.
Yes, it was a very literal, not a supernatural one that was, you know, somewhere in the Earth's core or something along those lines. And I think it's also very important to point out, and I sort of skipped over this when talking about the Hebrew Bible, but the Jewish belief around punishment and reward was that it happened in your earthly life, that it happened while you were a human being on the planet. So the book of Job is a perfect example of this because Job, for those unaware, is this character who, you know, has all this wealth, all these possessions, this land. He's got a lot of sons and daughters. And God makes a bet with the Satan. It's not Satan. It's the adversary of God. This is actually a character who is on God's divine counsel. And this adversary says to God, you know, I bet you that we can take all that stuff away from him. We can make this guy, forgive the pun, his life a living hell. And he's going to lose faith in you. He's not going to trust you anymore. And God's like, ha ha, I'll have none of that. And he lets him do whatever he wants to him, which results in all his children dying, his wife leaving him, his, you know, cattle dying, his property burning. He gets boils all over his body, like really gets put through the ringer. And so there's this one section where he has three friends who approach him. And one of them says to him, the reason this is happening to you is because you're a sinner. God does not do this to people who are righteous. And so the idea with the Jewish people during this time was if you were given wealth and good fortune and good things happened to you, it was God rewarding you. But if you were a leper, if you became ill, if you had a family member who died, in fact, if you died, it was because you were a sinner. You did something to piss off God.
How do they reconcile that with, like, you know, a child that dies at birth?
It was just that.
They just don't, right?
Well, that's an interesting concept because depending who you talk to, there's a specific passage in Deuteronomy that says that the child shall not be punished for the sins of the father and vice versa. So so the knee-jerk reaction, especially that a lot of people will say is, oh, well, it's original sin. Well, that passage from Deuteronomy sort of nicks that one in the bud. But it also suggests that, you know, maybe there was something wrong with the child, that maybe the child was sinful. But there's also the idea too, because we see a lot of this in the New Testament, that there was possession and beasts that were taking over people's bodies and committing and making them attempt ferocious sins. So it could have been argued at that time, and I don't know with 100% certainty, but it could have been argued that, you know, this child was born sinful because they were possessed, or there must have been some devil work with the pregnancy. So there were all these sort of supernatural explanations for things like these. And oftentimes, again, because there was death involved, if you read, this is really elaborated in the letters of Paul, where Paul says, you know, the punishment for sin ultimately is death. So if you died, it was because you were a sinner. And that's sort of a common theme we still see in evangelical circles, that the only reason death happens, forget that, you know, all this medical technology has come along and really explained a lot of the reasons why people die and explained, like, what happens to the cell makeup of our bodies and everything and why we eventually die. But no. It happens because you sinned. So a lot of that is carried out from this time frame, too.
And that fetus knows what it did.
So there's the whole, you know, biblical side of what is or isn't, you know, considered part of this afterlife. But what I really like that you did, Matthew, in your book was take the scripture, but then take a scientific approach to looking at all of this and really examining, like, is there an afterlife? Is there a soul? Like, what happens after our time on Earth is done? And so I guess, like, let's talk about death a little bit. Like, how... So you define death, I think, essentially as like irreversible cessation of life, right?
Yeah.
And one of the chapters in your book that, I mean, I think I sent you a message about it when I was reading. You kind of talked about like what's the difference between being an actual person and being a human being? Like, what does it really mean to like be alive in a sense? You gave a story about like Jane and Sally. Know what I'm talking about in the book?
Like, yes.
Can you kind of describe that a little bit? Because this was very interesting to me as I was reading, because it kind of made me think about just what it is to be a living person. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and please correct me if I'm wrong. I think I've got the right reference in my head. But so the example I had set up is, okay, if we have these two women, they're traveling in a car together and mm-hmm. they get into a horrific accident.
Yes, this is totally.
Yeah. Okay. So one of the women, her body is completely mutilated, but her brain is still intact and not damaged at all. And, you know, like there's signs that she's still alive, but it's very likely that she'll never be able to use her body again. Whereas the other woman who was in the accident had significant brain trauma and would not have any chance of coming back to life. So in a hypothetical, extremely advanced situation where doctors could do this, they go in and they surgically remove the brain from woman number one and put it into woman number two's body. And so the question is, okay, even though woman number two, like her body is still fully intact, any of her friends approached her would know her as woman number two, she would have woman number one's brain in her head. So when she wakes up, her consciousness, her memory, everything that she, like how she talks, her mannerisms, how she acts are all the identity parts of woman number one. So the question is, when woman number two, that being wakes up, who is that person? Is it woman number one or woman number two?
See, and like, and thinking about that, like I'm inclined to say it's the person whose like brain and mannerisms and like feelings and personality, I don't know. Like I feel like we're that, like that's who we are, isn't it? Maybe.
I feel like a more plausible situation, and again, this is like 2, 5, 6 thousand years away, but I would think it would be more easily done to download somehow all the thoughts and memories and things that you have, and then take that and put it onto a computer, and of course by that time we would have, you know, AI would be probably already running the world, if not pretty close, but. I mean, that seems more plausible to me would be to just download you somehow from your head onto a computer, and then we can put you into another person's body like that.
Right. So, but it's still personality and feelings and memories and all of that. So it's your
that's how I figure that it's person number one, because like we're just walking sacks of meat that have something that tells us where to go and how to grunt the right way to one another to communicate.
Well, and then Matthew also in the book brought up that Terry Schiavo case from like, I mean, that's a while ago now at this point, but the idea, I mean, this woman was essentially on like life support, right? And but not functioning as a person, but she was a body, right? I mean, I'm not trying to be disrespectful to this
of course
person, no, no, no. But it's like, but it makes you think, like, if a person gets to the point where they are essentially just a, you know, being kept alive physically, I mean, what are you at that point, you know? So yeah. I don't know. It's just like this is all very interesting to me, giving some thought to this stuff. And I mean, Matthew, as you were writing it, did you like come to any personal, like have any revelations or conclusions?
Well, for me, what it really outlines more than anything is the more advanced we get with our technology, the finer the line becomes between life and death, really. Because I mean, you know, Terri Schiavo, as much as her parents might have argued for, like, yes, yeah, she was alive, but she was not alive as herself. Like you said, she was more or less just this, you know, again, not to be disrespectful at all, but because she had no ability to communicate. I mean, if you contrast this even with someone like Stephen Hawking, who is still incredibly limited in his mobility and his ability to communicate, but he still at least has enough where he can communicate through a computer, through other various means. Like, I know he has been working with someone with typing out like new concepts and new ideas that he has come up with. And from what I understand, because he's also, you know, getting older, that it's become more slower and, you know, his disease is progressively getting worse for him. But that aside, you know, Terri Schiavo didn't even have that sense of mobility about her where she could do anything that would give any sort of indication of how she was feeling, how she was thinking, maybe the type of music she wanted to listen to or food she wanted to eat. I don't even think she could eat on her own.
I think that was an issue too. It was because it was, she was being fed through a feeding tube. And if I remember correctly, I mean, that was part of the whole thing too, is like at what point do you stop those measures?
Yeah.
And so she was, you know, a human being because she was alive, but the personhood seems like it maybe disappears at some point.
Yeah. And so that, I mean, that ultimately is what sort of drove the one of the more major points that I was arguing for in the book, which is that, you know, our consciousness, our sense of self, our personality, all that is tied to our brain. And very much like our brain is a computer for ourselves. If you take your computer and you slam it against the ground and suddenly your screen is destroyed and you can't see it anymore, well, that's because you damage the computer. You damage one of the most important parts of it. And now you're going to have an incredibly difficult time doing any of the tasks you had some use before. And so, you know, with the brain damage that was caused to Terri Schiavo through was a heart attack, I believe it was, that ended up creating all the problems for her, but her brain ended up becoming so incredibly damaged from that she really had no ability to self-sustain, and so she needed all this machinery to keep her alive. And that again goes, you know, back to that point that I was making, that with the more advanced our technology becomes, the thinner that line comes between, you know, what is considered alive and what's considered death, because they could have at any point just flicked a switch and she would have shut off and been considered dead. So that's ultimately what I was trying to get at with that.
Yeah. And so there's life, there's death. And then there's, I think, people who hope that there is something afterwards, and they hope that the soul continues. And like, and one, I will say the best things I think that you wrote in this book, just one sentence that I wrote down when I was reading, is belief in an idea doesn't make it a real thing. Mm-hmm. Which, I mean, let's apply that to so many things, but the soul, right? I mean, people, I think, want to believe, right? And there's a staggering number of people who believe in like reincarnation or, you know, somehow continuing after this. But looking at this from a scientific perspective, like, what did you learn about the possibility of a soul existing?
I mean, what I really learned is that there's no possibility of a soul. So one of the things I was really excited to tackle with this section was, I remembered from when I was maybe the beginning of my college years or maybe the end of my high school years, I had watched this short, it wasn't a documentary, but just this short, like 30 minute, it might've been something like Unsolved Mysteries or something like that, where they talked about this doctor who weighed bodies as people were dying. And when the people died, you know, the weight shifted and they lost weight, and oh my God, he really proved that people have a soul. And if you go and you actually look at the study that this person conducted, it happened in the beginning of the 20th century. It was done in literally within the first 10 years of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. And he was doing it in a tuberculosis house, like people who were like, they have tuberculosis, they're going to die. This is basically their final resting place, or the place where they're going to live out the last few days that they have left. And so he got all these people, there were six total people that he was able to conduct these experiments with. And none of them played out the same way. He had one patient who, when they died, lost weight, but wasn't able to replicate that in any of the five other times, because there were situations where people lost weight and then gained it back. There were situations where people gained weight, and then there were situations where people lost no weight at all. And so he's still, like, because he was sort of this person who tackled science more for the fame than for actually making any type of discovery, brought his finding out to the press and said, oh, look what I did, here's my findings, and look, this person lost weight when they died, so that means there's a soul. And the, you know, it was in Massachusetts, so the local press, like, just jumped all over this, blew it up, and was like, oh my God, this amazing discovery, they've proven that there's a soul once and for all. But other scientists came out and were like, he did it on six people and didn't get the same results any time he did it. So,
like, really small sample size and really inconsistent results, but but still, exactly. Soul, yeah.
And what's interesting to note, too, there are other people who have carried out similar experiments, not with humans, but there is a farmer that that was doing it on his sheep when they died. And it was sort of the same thing. Like, the results were all over the place. He could never get a consistent find. And he wrote it off as just like, well, you know, God works in mysterious ways. It's like, no, no. Like, there should be a consistent result with this, and there's not. But then there was another guy who took the same results and then hypothesized, well, a soul must weigh this much. And by the way, this is how much Jesus' soul weighs, which is apparently, according to him, because he's Jesus, it was close to a full pound. But
that's a heavy soul. That's a lot of soul.
It makes sense that they would use, imperial instead of metric. That's a topic of a different podcast.
Well, he used metric, but it was equivalent to, I just remember, like, it said in the book I was reading that it was almost a full pound, but he caps that argument off with, and this is how much a leprechaun soul would weigh.
What? We go from Jesus to leprechaun? Well, I guess because they're just as real as each other. So that sense. Wow. Okay. See, it's like, then they just get silly with it. And it's like, how do you take that seriously?
Yeah.
No, that's the part that gets silly. Okay. Gotcha. That's where we're drawing the line.
My line is at leprechauns, guys. That's it. That's my like magical creature line. Leprechauns. I'm at leprechauns. Well, you keep going.
Okay. So Lucky Charms for breakfast tomorrow. Yes. But the real interesting thing about all of this, and this really ties into all of it, sort of the big eye-opening thing for me. I mean, this was sort of a point for me that was very, very similar to that moment where I came to the realization that God doesn't exist and the religious beliefs I followed, you know, aren't real, which was I had gone into writing the book and thinking about it with, you know, it's very unlikely that it exists, but maybe we just don't know enough about it. I still had this really incredibly selfish part of, maybe there's a chance that, you know, my consciousness continues after I die. And then Sean Carroll comes into the picture and completely smashes that concept for me, where, you know, Sean Carroll is this, I believe he's a theoretical physicist. I could be mistaken on that, but I know he works with quantum mechanics specifically in the realm of physics. And he had said, okay, so the area that I really focus in my work, these are his words, paraphrase, not my own, I should say, but he said, the area that I really work in, you know, we know how everything affects everything else on a quantum level, that there are really these four very, very minuscule particles that make up everything. There are these four little quarks. And so you can imagine it this way. Imagine that there are four people on rowboats out in the middle of a lake, and they're grouped relatively close together, close enough that one of them has a sack of potatoes, and he takes it and throws it to one of the other boats. So the person in that boat catches it, and when he catches it, the waves that he creates by catching the potatoes end up affecting the other three boats. And that's sort of how this realm of physics works, where when one area is active or is affected by something interacting with the physical world, whether it's a photon that pops in and out of existence very quickly, or it's something like somebody, you know, breathing or walking along the sidewalk, you know, we can see all that effect in the quantum realm based on these four little particles, because they create waves when they're affected, and it affects the other three. The thing is, we would be able to detect any supernatural element that came into our world or that was leaving from our world, and we don't see that. Yeah. So these four little particles like give no indication that there's anything that leaves our body when we die, or that God's hand comes out of the clouds and, you know, zaps down a member of ISIS when they've, you know, hurt a Christian or anything
yeah.
like that.
The group that he created in the first place, mind
yes.
you.
Yes.
yeah. Yeah. So there's nothing there, like in the laws of physics, huh? That just like would allow or show that our consciousness like continues.
Yeah. And the, after. And it's, thank you for bringing up the consciousness aspect, because the important thing to note too, is that with our own consciousness, that is something that we can actually trace in our minds with the neurons that are in there. So there is this very physical, very real thing that takes place in our heads that moves around when we create thoughts, when we create memories. And, you know, how does a physical thing attach itself to an immaterial thing like the soul and then take off somewhere? The likelihood of anything like that happening is completely improbable and unrealistic. So it's unlikely that even if there was such a thing as the soul, that any of our consciousness would travel along with it too.
Yeah. So there's no afterlife and there's no soul. So my question for you guys, as we kind of like come to the end of this discussion, is like, what does this mean for us now and how we live our lives? Like, as people who understand this, that there's nothing after.
I mean, the most literal way that I've ever used this word, YOLO.
I mean, because you literally only live once, don't you? I mean, it's true. And I mean, I think, but see, for me, I guess I feel like it makes it all more meaningful that we're living for what we have now. And like, we might be these like little insignificant specks on the planet, but like we can do good things with the time here.
And that's something I never understood, was why if a theist honestly believes that the afterlife is going to be perfect and they're going to have like every single like dog that they've ever owned and goldfish, and grandma's going to be there, and then grandma's going to be and it's going to be just the best thing ever. Like, why take diabetes medicine? Like, why even bother? Why get chemo for your cancer? Like, why wouldn't you do everything or not do anything to postpone that if that is truly like what you believe?
I don't have an answer for that one.
I don't either. But that is the argument I usually use when, yeah, when Christians tell me I should just kill myself. it's like, you got this backwards.
But they're morally superior to you too. Just in case you didn't know, in case you forgot.
Yes. Well, I mean, you know, they do have that God that, you know, questioned why humanity thought they were worthy. So, but you know, what I think it ultimately means to me is, you know, like Natalie was saying, you know, this, it makes the life we have more meaningful. It makes, you know, the actions that we have, the friendships that we create more meaningful. We should be taking, you know, we should be taking our actions seriously. We should, you know, think before we act, especially when we go to the voting booth. Too little, too late, I know. But
or if we don't go to the voting booth at all.
Well, 2018, you guys, 2018, everybody's going to do the right thing for sure. Yeah.
But the other end of it too is, I think if we can get more people to understand this and to really realize this is the only life that we have, we'll stop having people, what I would hope at least is that we'll stop having people who, you know, do horrendous things towards other people, that they'll stop infringing on others' rights to, you know, just live as who they are, and stop making people fearful to live in the closet. Because if they come out as who they are, whether it's because of their gender identity, sexual orientation, the political ideologies that they have, or even the religious beliefs or lack thereof, you know, these people don't hide out of fear that they're going to be attacked because, you know, we're supposed to kill infidels, we're supposed to stone homosexuals, or people that were born anatomically male but identify as female and vice versa. So, but we also have situations where in the Middle East there are incredibly large numbers of honor killings that happen because the families feel that dishonor is brought upon the family because of one action or another. It's typically an action carried out by a woman, and they think that in order for their family to be brought on the right side of God, that they need to kill this person. And so they end up taking the life of somebody else so that their family can receive reward in the afterlife, what they believe is coming in the afterlife. And so, you know, I think it would do a huge service to people who are victims of such behavior. It would do a huge favor to them in order to, like, prevent that from happening and prevent people from thinking, like, I've got to do this here and now because after I die, this is what I want to have happen.
Yeah. And I think, you know, we've gone to this little, like, theme on a number of the shows when we touched on kind of atheist and secular topics of, you know, they're, like, being a little, like, life's a little bit better without the pressure of the God issue. And, you know, you don't have to have God to be good, and life, you know, you don't have to have promise of an afterlife to live a good life now. And it might actually be a lot lighter and better of a life without the fear and worry of what's coming next.
It's the adult equivalent of your parent, a parent telling a child, well, you better be good or Santa won't bring you any presents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of is. And so yeah, Matthew, I will say when I kind of concluded reading your book, like, it's funny how, you know, at the same time, you're essentially saying, okay, like, there's nothing after this. But as I read it, like, I mean, because you know, you added your own personal touch to it. Like, it felt hopeful, and it touched me when I read it. So I think, you know, it's a misconception that, like, it's not just this cold idea that, well, there's nothing after, so there's no meaning now. It's like the meaning comes from now, and it's our job to, you know, make the most of it for ourselves and for other people, like, because we have to be good to each other too. And now more than ever, I think that's the message that needs to be sent out there into the world too.
So thank you. And I really appreciate you saying that, because I really was worried, like, people are going to be so depressed after reading my book. But I'm glad that there was, you know, something positive you took out of the end of it too. So that gives me hope and makes me feel a little rewarded. So,
yeah. Well, so thank you so much for talking to us. And, you know, we'll have links to, you know, your books and everything in the notes for the show. But if people want to, like, follow you on Twitter or Facebook or whatever, where can they find you on the internet?
Sure. So you can follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is @MWONEII. Someone else had the name. There's no variation of my name on Twitter that wasn't already taken. So the last I is capitalized. So MWONEII. And you can like my Facebook page, my author Facebook page, facebook.com/YouSayThatIAm.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. And I'm sure you'll talk to us again sometime. And, you know, I'll see you around on Twitter.
Yeah, absolutely. I hope so. Thank you.
All right.
reason we love the internet this week. We are very happy to have Matthew return after he had already done an interview with us to talk about this reason we love the internet, because I think that the reason we love the internet this week is the thing that made Matthew and I realize that we're kindred spirits, in a way, because it's evil Kermit memes. And the one I want to start with is one that I have saved on my phone because this is my life story. It says, me, don't be a weirdo at this social event. Me to me, give unnecessary information to strangers about Jeffrey Dahmer. And that's the Natalie Newell story right there, I think. And I saw this one.
I don't know what that's supposed to mean.
Wait, hold on. You don't know who Jeffrey Dahmer is?
No. I know that part.
But it's like,
I don't know what the second part's supposed to mean.
It's, you don't understand it. It's like you're saying to, like, first you're like, okay, I'm going to be normal. And then, like, your inner self is like, no, tell people about cannibals. Like,
I mean,
you don't
it's
get
the
it?
Inner struggle. It's the, it like, is. I want to be pro-social and likable and have people think that I'm normal. And then the inner struggle of, this is what I really want to do. And I know it's going to freak everyone out.
Yeah. And so, I found that one.
I've never had that thought in my head. I mean, I'm more asocial than antisocial is like seeking to destroy social situation. I'm just I just don't want to be around people. Like, I'm literally home alone right now. Like, I mean, my kids, well, great, yada, yada, yada. But like, otherwise, like, leave me alone.
Oh no. See, I just thought it was funny. Cause it's like, I just like to talk about weird stuff. And I saw that one, I think right before or after I recorded that episode about cannibalism that is coming out later this month. I did with Buck and James. And it's just like, yeah, it's kind of what my Chrome browser tabs are right now, is weird shit. And, you know, it is the inner struggle to know when you can talk about weird things with people. And so Matthew, we could talk about weird stuff. And absolutely. And yeah, just funny. It's just funny, Dan. Fun.
I looked at it in two ways. One was the way that I just described, of like that inner struggle of, I want people to like me, but I also really am tempted to be weird because that's how I really am. But the other side of it too is like, it's sort of those internalized thoughts you've had if you've ever worked with other human beings. If it's, you know, just in like a coworker situation, or even if it's, you know, it's like working in food service or customer service of some type. I mean, like, people spout off weird things and, you know, it's like, I don't want to offend them because I'm around these people and, you know, I don't want to have a nasty work atmosphere. So it's sort of like, oh yes, tell me more about your religion. Meanwhile, inside you're like, tell them you worship Satan or something. Yes. Along those lines.
It's the inner struggle. Okay, Dan, here, I found one on the Twitter account that maybe hears you. Maybe. All right. So me, I'm not going to get mad. It's just a video game. And then other me, so like the evil hooded Kermit, is like, tell him he's trash. You're going to kill his family and rage quit. Like, is that what people do in video games?
I mean,
no. Okay. All right.
It doesn't happen as much as you think, but okay. I mean, you know.
Yeah. It happens.
When it does, you're just like, oh, well, then there's this asshole. I mean, at least I'm like that. Like, yes. I don't get upset.
Oh, here. I mean,
because that requires me to feel feelings in the first place. So, you know.
Okay. All right. I found one. I found one, maybe.
I think it's all the right, one that so, I'm looking at right now.
So me, she's asking what I do for work. Should I tell her I make memes? Other me. Really? No, you are a social media content creator.
Yeah, exactly.
That's you.
Yeah. I mean,
that's what you are.
And full disclosure, like, I base, like, when I'm meeting somebody on Tinder or whatever, and like, they're like, oh, what do you do for fun? And I'm like, well, I have this thing. And like their response to that is kind of like an indicator of how much I'm going to get along with this person. Some people are like, oh, that's cool, let's talk about this. And I'm like, whoa, but ooh, I need to not say that.
You're like, whoa, lady.
See, that makes me like, I hate that I can't say that, because I would say like, whoa, dick, but like, I don't know how I feel about it. That's the topic of another podcast.
Oh, Dan.
I'm like, whoa, lady, I don't think we're going to get along very much.
So, good so Kermit. Right. Tell them everything's all right. Bad Kermit. Play along with it. See how deep he goes.
Yeah. See, like all of them. It's just, it is the inner struggle. That's what the evil Kermit is. And I just, like, I don't know. I think that they're funny. And Dan obviously is like, meh, I don't know.
I can take it or leave it.
You take it or leave it. That's fine.
It's just a lot of the exact same format for me.
Yeah, so you need your memes a little more varied.
I need something. It's one of those, it's just funny for a little bit, but damn, like I'm looking at like
it needs more.
It's obviously just,
yeah.
I mean, I have to scroll back a lot here. I have to imagine.
Yeah. See, like, because I have some that I just have saved on my phone. Like me, well, I just woke up. Time to be productive. Me, stare at your phone in bed for an hour. That's me. Well, see, but that's me like waking up at weird times throughout the night. And then I'm like, oh, let me check Twitter because I need to see what's happening on Twitter at 2 a.m. because that's important.
Yeah, I'll just check my page for a second and then 3 hours later.
Right. See, like that's my Kermit struggle. Just staring at my phone, which is actually just cracked to shit at the moment too. Like, so I'm just staring at a cracked screen and memes. Because we're all addicted to technology. All of us, I think. Pretty much.
I think my evil Kermit is, the kids are waking up. I should probably get up and change them and bring them downstairs for breakfast. Then there's the inner me, which is someone else will figure it out sooner or later.
Oh my God, that is, yes, I agree with that one. Or it's just like,
pretend you're asleep still.
Yeah, they'll be okay for a few more minutes, like while I check Twitter and while I like get myself completely ready for the day. No, actually, it's more like just during the night, I definitely check my phone. But in the morning, I'm more just like, okay, kids are, they're kind of talking to themselves, but they're having important conversations that I will not interrupt them from just yet. And they actually stash Legos in their room too, and entertain themselves. So, my evil Kermit's okay in the morning then, because I just let him be. I think.
I mean, you leave kids alone with Legos long enough, you'll come and find something built sooner or later, I guess.
Yeah, totally. Built or they're all just scattered, like in a pattern that seems like, okay, you've put these out in the most annoying way to clean up, like one every couple feet, like the rug is just a landmine of very small pieces of Lego, and it's just fun for the whole family to clean up and try not to step on. I've actually started wearing shoes more in the house because I mean that fucking hurts.
And then you find out some odd years later that was actually like his modern art piece that you had completely destroyed, and he's going to go to a therapist about it.
Oh my God.
Mom destroyed it and didn't even appreciate it.
I know.
I'm sorry. So, I'm getting anxiety describing that now.
Oh man. I am in a constant state of like messing up their lives. Constant. Legos, everything. Yeah. All right. Well, that's being a parent, I guess. I just
sleep until about 3 o'clock in the afternoon and figure that they'll figure it out eventually.
They'll just get themselves set, and
we gotta teach them independence somehow.
Yeah, I guess I can't do that yet with a 3-year-old and a 2-year-old. They're not there yet. they are not self-sufficient humans. Like, one can just about go to the bathroom by himself without me. We're small steps. Small steps, guys. I'm getting there. Maybe.
My children think that Cheetos are breakfast and that pulling the hooks off of the ornaments on the Christmas tree is appropriate. So no, we're not there yet.
But you know what? Is anyone ever there? Really? We're all evil Kermit.
If you enjoyed the show, please consider checking out our Patreon page at patreon.com/TSEpodcast to get access to premium content such as extended interviews, early episode access, and other goodness. And Natalie and I would appreciate you buying us a beer or two. Or, I'm sorry, she's classy. She drinks bourbon.
Yeah, keep it classic.
We understand not everyone can afford to financially contribute to the show, and that's totally okay. Just tell your friends about us. That's how we will continue to grow. But if you could, just like James, Alice, all four of these Michaels, Chris, Sarah, Janet, Amanda, Astrid, Andrew, Jeff, Susan, and Trevor have done, we would be incredibly grateful. Natalie, hit us with a quote.
A belief in an idea doesn't make it a real thing. And that is from Matthew O'Neill, our wonderful guest tonight. So thank you again to Matthew for being an awesome guest. And he also listens to the show. So thank you, Matthew, for listening to the show.
Yeah.
It's awesome. That's really cool. Next week, we're going to have an interview with Dr. Shaun Sellars. He is a dentist. So we talked a lot about dental woo type of stuff. And he's also... one of the hosts of the Last Tuesday Project podcast. So we talked about podcast stuff, skepticism, and we ended by talking about music because why not? So it was a really fun interview with a good friend, and excited to share it with the listeners next week. And yeah.
All right. We'll see you next week.
Bye, everybody.
The music you heard tonight was written and performed by Adam Johnson and was used with his permission. You can contact Adam at AdamJohnsonDC@gmail.com. This podcast is property of Not Narrow or Straight LLC, all rights reserved.